This is our Torah in history, or I like to call it World Parsha Rewind. Looking at the events of the world from the newspaper of the day, which is Parshas HaShavua, or of course the Yom Tovim. Davar Be'ito Matov. Hashem sends us all the information we need to know. So I just returned from Uman, and I had the... Yes. I came back a little bit early. Because to be present in Eretz Yisrael and helpful to family, etc. And Uman is a wonderful experience. I'm sure you have certain questions about Uman if you care to ask. I can raise some of the questions for you, and then you can add if you want. But my purpose here is to give over some of the ideas, concepts, and stories that I heard in Uman as a preparation for Yom Kippur from the lens of the literature of the Aseres Yemei Tshuva, which is, of course, our Hilchos Tshuva, the laws of Tshuva, and the Seder Avoda of Yom Kippur, and the psukim that describe the order of the day that we will read and that we will go through very carefully as part of the Musaf Davening and actually reenact it. We actually... one of the only two times in the year that we are allowed to bow down, to be mishtachaveh, right? Anachnu korim. I don't know if the ladies are all doing it. Ladies are doing it. Kol hakavod, because there's no difference between a man and a woman regarding this thing. If you came to the Beis HaMikdash, you had to bow down to Hashem when you heard the name of Hashem.
Women in the Beis HaMikdash bow down?
As far as I know. I don't know why. If they heard the Shema Mefurish, why wouldn't they? Of course, they might have been positioned in a place they might not have heard it as clearly. However, it's one of the really few times in the year where we reenact and we imagine ourselves as actually performing a service in the Beit HaMikdash, which is pretty rare. Of course, on Rosh Hashanah, we bow down only how many times? One time, because it's why do we bow down? We bow down at which juncture in the service? Aleinu, that's, but in Yom Kippur, we bow down three times. Once in each of the stages of the cleansing process, which are threefold. This is very significant. Aaron, for himself and for his family. Then, it's Aaron for himself and family and the Kohanim. And finally, for himself, the Kohanim, and Am Yisrael. A threefold part of Kapara. In fact, the Mishnah in Shavuos tells us, in Horios tells us, the end of the first parak, that there's two processes going on. There's the blood of the Seir that's brought bifnim. We know that the Seder Avoda is that there are two identical Seirim that are brought. As the Pasuk tells us, here in Parshat Yom, V'lokach es shnei ha-Seirim. You take these two identical goats. They're actually goats. V'hemid osam lifnei Adonai Pesach Omo. And you stand them up in front of Hashem. Why? Why do they, they're goats, they're not people. Why do they need to be stood up in front of Hashem? People stand. Animals don't stand. They're like presented to Hashem. V'nasan Aaron es shnei ha-se'irim goralot, and he makes a goral, right, which is a lottery. Gorel echad ladonai, v'gorel echad la'azazel. What in the world is that? Everything should be l'Hashem. Right? Hashem ha'aretz u'maloa. Tevel v'yoshreva. So why are we giving anything to Azazel? And who is Azazel anyway? That's a joke. Who the Azazel is Azazel, right? And what does that mean, Azazel? It's a very strange word. So halachically, we know that the Mishnah Yuma describes it as a tzuk, a place which is a very rocky, pointed, hilly terrain. It's like a cliffs, jagged cliffs, where the Kohen, once he decides which one is which and raises the lottery, He will then, as part of the service, send out this Seir HaMishtaleach with an Ish Iti, a man of the times, it means a designated individual, who carries it 10 stations. They had 10 booths, sukkah booths, waiting for the man who would walk this distance with the Seh. Oh, you think you should let him in. Poor guy. He also wants kapara. He also wants tshuva. It's bittul Torah for him. All right. See, rachamav al kol ma'asav.
The previous speaker couldn't stand having on her feet.
Oh, okay. I don't mind. I don't mind. Charlie, right? Charlie?
Yeah.
God bless Charlie. Okay, now. So we have this sukkah. We have 10 stations. Each one has a sukkah. And the Ish Iti, the designated man, often was a Kohen, didn't have to be a Kohen, would escort the Seir HaMishtaleach over a ramp, a gesher. Why did they need to make a gesher? Because the foreign Jews, the Jews from America, Babylon was the America of the day, right? The Jews who came from Chutz La'aretz were a little bit wild. Isn't that true, you know? General. Americans are a little more, you know, Israelis are Haredim anyway, tend to be a little more reserved. Okay.
Huh?
The
British included?
The Israelis always say, like, the American women, when they see each other, squealing,
make a lot of noise. Right. So that was always the case. So, and the reason for that is because in Eretz Yisrael, you're living in front of the king. You know, somebody's watching you all the time. You have to behave. And you feel like you're in Chutz La'aretz, kol adar b'chutz la'aretz kilu in lokal. This is a free-for-all. So therefore, you're free. So they would want to tear the hair off this little poor goat and say, Tol Vitzei, get that goat out of here. He's carrying all of our veros. Get him out of here. They want to tear him. They would have torn him to bits right there. Forget the tzuk. They were going to tear him to pieces right there. So in order to make sure that the halacha was done properly, they had a bridge that carried him over the population so that the poor little Gedi would live a bit longer and not suffer an untimely and death in front of the masses. And in each sukkah that they passed, the Mishnah tells us, they would say to the man, eat, drink. It's Yom Kippur. Why? Because if that Selah Zazel doesn't make it to the tzuk, we're all in trouble. So his individual, it's a question, individually he's not allowed to break Yom Kippur. No. Not that he ever did it, but he had to know that it was theoretically okay for him to strengthen himself with food and drink in order to fulfill this command of throwing it over the tzuk. Again, it was more for psychological reasons than practical reasons, but it was entrenched in the Mishnah as a real, real thing. They did put this into the place of how this procedure went. And then when he gets to the tzuk, he ties it up with this red bow. Tzuk is a craggy cliff, sharp-edged cliff, sharp rocks like razors. And then he would tie up and toss the Seir HaZazel overboards, backwards, and it was torn to bits by the time it reached the bottom. All of this is the Mishnah describing what these few psukim, it says, befeirish. So a few questions we've asked. Number one, why do we need this, the Seir HaZazel altogether? Number two, why does it have to go through this? Why do they want to destroy it? Okay. Three, why the 10 booths? Four, the red string on the tied onto the horns of the Seir HaZazel, what would happen to it once it was destroyed? It would turn white. What does that mean? What is the symbolism of that, of the red turning into white? Why is that important? And they said that there was a companion string also in the Beit HaMikdash itself. And when one transformed, the other transformed. That's how they knew How did they know, the Mishnah asks, that he arrived at the tzuk? They say, well, either they could pace it out, or they would time it by thinking about how much distance it would take over, or that Lashon also changed. So what? The connection never ends. I mean, these two things are like, literally, they have to be identical. They have to be the same shape, the same size, the same worth, the same appearance. Why is this the central point of Yom Kippur? You know, if you were explaining to a Gentile, and one of the very things about Uman is that Rabbi Shalom Arush, whose group I love to be included in, and I go to his lectures and I hang out with him a little bit and get brachas from him, etc. He has many Gentile followers because he writes books about faith and personal prayer. And a lot of Gentiles are very into personal prayer. They don't have a lot of mitzvos, you know what I mean? So they're very good at the praying part, because that's like the most important thing. Like they said about the guy who had this big church in Houston. You heard about this? There was a guy who had this massive mega church in Houston. Oh, yeah. So guess what? What did they think that they was going to do with the church?
Taking all the
poor people, right? Charity and acts of good deeds. No way, man. He kept it locked. Is it going to mess up my carpet? This is for prayer. There's nothing else that happens here but prayer. And maybe some, you know, but acts of chesed? That's not on my roster.
And why backwards?
Why backwards? Exactly. Why backwards? Toss them backwards. It's just strange. So we have a lot of questions here. I'm going to ask another question. At the end of the Mishnayos and Yuma that were described here, Rabbi Akiva makes a very well-known but also enigmatic statement. He says, Ashreichem Yisrael, lifnei mi atem metar, who is purifying you, right? Umi metar eschem, and who are you doing it in front of, and who's purifying you? What do you mean? Lifnei mi atem metar, umi metar eschem, isn't that all redundant? Just mi metar eschem, who the answer, of course, we know. What's the answer? Who's metar, who's purifying us? Avinu shebashamayim, our God in heaven. What's the proof? He brings a proof text. He says, why? What's the pasuk? It says, ma mikvah, he quotes the phrase, ma, this is his language, ma mikvah mitayres atmeim, a mikvah cleanses the impure, afa kodesh baruch hu mitayres yisroel. Ma mikvah mikadesh es atmeim, mitayres atmeim, afa kodesh baruch hu mitayres. As it says, mikvah yisroel Hashem. Hashem is the mikvah. As far as I turn, are you allowed to go into the mikvah in Yom Kippur? There's only one guy that goes into the mikvah in Yom Kippur, and that is the Kohen Gadol himself. So why does, as the wide analogy of Yom Kippur, does Rabbi Akiva apply the concept of mikvah? We don't go to the mikvah. Kohen Gadol does go to the mikvah as part of his avoda. But why is that the real pshat in what's going on here? He nailed it. What about mikvah? Okay. Now there is a mitzvah to go to mikvah Erev Yom Kippur for that reason. Erev Yom Kippur, right? For men, even for men. So in order to understand some of these things, I'm going to tell you by way of a story, okay? A couple stories from Uman, which we'll go back and explain these questions. All right. So I always make like a little, I haven't done it yet, but when I come back, I collect my thoughts and I try to capture on paper or in some way in writing, what did I get out of this year? What did I learn this year? And what do I therefore want to carry forward to next year? Because you forget, you think you're always going to remember, but of course you don't. So traveling there, I had a most unusual experience. I was on a charter plane. And it was all very lovely people, mostly, you know, Israelis, a lot of Sephardim and Kibbutz Ugot, but also Hasidim a little bit, and Yeshivish people and Hasidim, and very, very nice. Everybody was very nice. Everybody was very happy. A couple of them were a little more rowdy, Amcha, you know, because one of the major phenomenons of Uman, which we have to understand, is that it's a tremendous draw just for the average simple Jew. Average simple Jew. Very, very like Masorti, Sephardim, flock there by the thousands. And with a Sephardi, you can never know how religious they are. Did you know that? Because they may not have a kippah, and they're wearing jeans and sneakers. You don't know. But this is the guy that davens with like the most intense kavana ever. I was just in the airport, and a guy walked up for lost and found. He wasn't wearing yarmulke or anything. He says, "Oh, I lost my tikshel tefillin," like it was his most important possession. The guy wasn't even wearing a yarmulke, because that's not their minhag. You know, they're not their minhag. I stay with Sephardim. I stay with Syrians, so I get the accent over yonder. But it's the draw is so powerful. And all right, so a little liquor did come out. Now, I'm running a disclaimer here, because a lot of people who are anti-Breslov or anti-Umo say, "Oh, it's just the wild people." But I say, look, they're going to be having a good time somewhere, right? That's where they're holding. So let them have a good time here. It's like a lot of young people go, and they organize food, and they camp out, and they cook. If they didn't do it here, they'd be doing it in Nepal or somewhere, right? Anyway, they're going for the camping out, and they're having the big, you know, they're that age. They need that excitement, energy, and entertainment. So let them do it with the tzaddik. Right? So I'm not sympathetic to the criticism. I don't think anybody should be. But, okay, so apparently there was one guy who did have a drinking problem, and he happened to be sitting right next to me.
On the plane.
So I noticed that, you know, Johnny Walker went to Uman. And okay, but people were making l'chaim, and that was the extent of it, you know, a little simcha, liven it up. And I kind of fell asleep. It was late in the night. When I got up, we're ready to get off the plane, the fellow across from the aisle, his feet are in the aisle, and he's out cold. Out cold. And like, you know, he was asleep, but I mean asleep. You know, and his friend was next to him. Now, the problem is nobody can wheel their bags down this little aisle. You know, these are not big planes. And his leg is there, and he wanted to get hurt. It was a yeshiva guy, like, you know, not probably someone in their 30s, maybe in their 30s. Had a little beard. Nice looking, looked like a Ben Torah, nice guy. He has a problem with alcohol. He literally passed out. Now, prior to that, now this guy's name was Chaim. Okay? But he kept saying L'chaim, but he was showing no signs of Chaim at that moment, okay? None. There was another guy who was sitting right in front of me, who was a boisterous, young Sephardic guy. He had arms like, he was like built like a tank, short and strong and labedic and loud and fun and carrying on. I'm sitting right behind him, and I'm going, I don't know if I'm ever going to get any sleep on this flight. Okay, fine, let them enjoy. So, but when I get up, we don't know what to do with Chaim. And I tried to start rousing him, and his friends start gornished. Guys in back of me were trying to do something, and I'm getting nervous because people are going to want to get off the plane very soon. And he may get trampled, try to move his leg a little bit, nothing. So then I turned to the guy ahead of me. See, they have me, Binyamin, this very strong, young Sephardic guy. And I said, "Yesh baya, tzuchim la'iroto, ma'yepo, yidrosoto," they're going to say. So he just stands up, turns around, picks the guy up, and he wasn't not such a tiny guy, literally picked him up and carried him off the plane. Not only did he carry him off the plane, but he placed him in, you know, they have these little shuttle buses because you land on the tarmac, you know. This was in Yuliani Airport in Kiev, you know, which is not exactly a major destination for the world yet. But although one of the amazing things about Kiev in the years I've gone there is they have a world-class airport, whereas 15 years ago, it was a cement box with some guard with a Soviet-era hat that went up this high to look at your passport and stamp it, and that was the whole airport, and one little carousel like this. Okay, So it's exploded in majestically. And I believe in the schut of the world opening up in 1990, which is what we spoke about. The world opens up for the Geula in 1990. We got access to Kivrei Tzadikim. People started to come, and now, wow, are people coming. That airport is impressive. Much nicer than Kennedy. Much nicer than LaGuardia, nothing. This is like one of the nicest airports you'll see. Equivalent of Paris, equivalent of just big and nice. Okay, now. But we get out to this alternate airport, and he puts him on the bus. We get to the terminal. So over there, since it's a smaller airport, Giuliani, they still have the booths where they let you through. This, you know, guy's sitting in the booth, and they stamp your passports. We're waiting online. And all of a sudden, Chaim comes walking from the booths towards us. You know, he was walking the wrong way. You know, everybody's waiting online to get to the booth. All of a sudden, he emerges from the booth going this way somewhere. Whoa! He was still not really. He was awake, but not fully awake. Somebody had to turn him around, send him in the right direction. No, we're not going that way. We're going this way. Now we get to the carousel. We're waiting for our suitcases and praying. As I prayed with a lot of emunah, I prayed with a lot of fervent prayers, but my biggest and most fervent prayer was that my suitcase should arrive. So I could have yontif, shira malois, you know, hopefully it comes around. It wasn't a very large carousel either. All of a sudden, I'm looking for the suitcase, Who's laying down the carousel? Chaim.
Oh my God, going around?
He's laying like this, curled up, comfy, cozy. Could have put a blanket over him, and he's going around with the suitcases. Now, you know how it goes around once, you know, in the smaller airports, and it disappears behind a curtain? So here he comes around the corner, and he's coming around, and like, sure enough, there he goes behind the curtain. He's out. He goes right back into the baggage area. Rabbanu Shalom. Until finally comes around a second time, and he's like, yeah, leave me alone. I'm fine. I'm happy. He's very happy. Some Hasidic guy picked him up and took him off. I don't know what happened to Chaim the rest of Yontif, but it was such a scene for me to take in. I told Binyamin on the bus, on the shuttle bus, because at first, you know, Binyamin was, you know, it's not so pleasant. There's a lot of carrying on. There's a lot of noise, a lot of tumbling, maybe a l'chaim. It's a little uncomfortable. By the way, it was the only people on the plane. This is not, you know, it's a minority. It's not most of the people. It's a few percent of the people. And I said to him, you did a big mitzvah, you know, that you helped him off the plane and you did that, you know. It was a tremendous show of strength also to pick this guy and carry him down the stairs and onto the bus and get him in there. And he said, you know, yeah, you know, he thanked me for thanking him. And then it occurred to me, Binyamin and Chaim, okay? If Hashem says, one of the principles of Hasidus is that if you see something in life, who's the message for? For you. So what message? That's also a principle from the very first lesson of Rabbi Nachman, is look at life, look for the chachma in it. Don't waste your time. Don't go through life like you're a piece of baggage, asleep on the carousel of life, running around until it's curtains.
Oh.
Curtains, at some point, the carousel ends. But rather, you have to wake up and look for the chachma in everything. There's a way to serve Hashem. So how do you serve Hashem with that maisa? I said, you know, we're all chayim. Every Jew is chayim. Every person is chayim. We're asleep. We're asleep in this world. We're not cognizant of what's going on in Hashem's world. And we got to wake up. And who's going to wake us up? Binyamin. Binyamin is going to give Chaim to Klal Yisrael. What's Binyamin? Binyamin is the one who wasn't involved in Chet of Mechirat Yosef. He's not involved in Sinas Chinam, and he's not involved in Lashon Hara. And he's the place where the Beis HaMikdash resides, always resides in the place of Binyamin. A little strip of Binyamin ran to cover the place of the Mizbeach that's the focal point of the Aaron, of Aaron's work on Yom Kippur, resides partially, two sides of it are in the Shevet Binyamin territory, two sides of it are in Yehuda territory, but the two sides that are in Binyamin territory have the Yesod, have the base where the blood is sprinkled. Why? Because we say Tzadik, Yesod, Olam. And the Tzadikim are the ones who help us wake up and do the tshuva that we need to do to rouse ourselves in life. And that's what Binyamin does. So that was my metaphor. That was my original story. Well, welcome to Uman. Okay. So now, let me develop this to you, and I promise you I'm going to give you another story to end, okay? I promise. Bli neder. So let's understand a little bit more about what this waking up is all about. What is about going to Uman? Uman is really about waking up. The one thing that they do in Uman is that's most impressive is that when it comes to the bracha of HaMelech HaKadosh, you know what they do? They clap. You're sitting in a shul where I sit, which is the main shul, and Baruch Hashem, I have seats there and for many years, and you're hearing about 6,000-8,000 people clap. HaMelech. Long applause. We're giving applause to Hashem, not to ourselves. And the idea is, and this I also heard from Rabbi Arush there, he said, I want to tell you, he told us every Rosh Hashanah, you're not allowed to daven for yourself on Rosh Hashanah, anything. Don't daven for parnasah, and don't daven for this, and for shidduchim, and for children, and for da-da-da. Don't. It's not so much, not what you're here for. So what are we here for? Isn't that what Rosh Hashanah is all about? I come with my list, right? Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam, Shehakol Nivra. It's the supermarket of the year, right? The supermarket. I need a shidduch, I need parnasa, I need this problem, I need whatever it is I need, right? I'm going to load up my wagon, and I'm going to go to the checkout counter, and I'm going to get stamped for a new year. No. He says, I don't want any of you to daven for yourselves. He says, if you're going to, you're davening, what? That the Malchut Shamayim should be revealed to the world. The world should wake up out of our stupor. What is our stupor? That we think we're the Melech or the Malka. That's the big mistake. The big mistake is only, it's a binary mistake. It's either or. It's one question. Who is in charge? Who is the king or queen? There's only one, there are only two possibilities. Either it's you or somebody else other than Hashem or Hashem. That's the only two choices. And what we do on Rosh Hashanah is we daven not only for ourselves to understand the truth. We're in this for Hashem. We're not in this for ourselves. We have no personal agenda. We want Hashem to be recognized to the world. Now, if I work for Hashem, and I'm an employee of Hashem, then usually he pays good, you know? It's excellent pay. And usually, you know, he's like the nicest employer. Lahavdil, better than Donald Trump, you know? Donald Trump said he used to pay his women executives top salary. You know, for all that they said he's anti-women. But they made more money by him than anywhere else. By a long shot. He says, if you're good, you're a manager, you're doing my work, you get rewarded. So the story that illustrates this that I heard from Lazer Brody, who's Rabbi Arch's protege, he says that there was a king that wanted a new crown. He wanted a majestic crown. So he gave, excuse me. I don't know if you heard this story, but he put out a kol kore, you know, they call it a,
proclamation.
What's that? Proclamation, yeah, but it's also what they call it a, there's a business term for it, you know, like a call for bids.
Tender, yeah.
A tender, right, in Israel they call it a tender. Anyway, so, you know, all skilled artisans in, you know, metalwork and fabric work, because they can, please apply for, you know, this position, there'll be X amount of positions, this is the salary base, fine. So a group is assembled of the finest artisans, and they're given the best materials. They bring in gold and silver and all sorts of colorful threads, you know, for fabrics, and make me a crown befitting a great king. Now, they also needed assistance. You know, it's like Lahavdil by the Hollywood movies, you know? Every star has a personal attendant. Did you know that? Mm-hmm. They give them credits in the movie reels afterwards. They say, and the personal attendant of this star was so-and-so. That's a big position. So you need the artisans, and you need the schleppers, right? Because without schleppers, there's not, you know, nothing. You know, you expect the artisans to take care of all the details themselves? So they hired schleppers, and they hired artisans. They gave them a generous, generous salary. He said, the king said to them, work 8 hours a day. The rest of the time I'm providing you with facilities for rest and strengthening yourself for the work. I'm going to give you a swimming pool, health club. We have chefs here that will cook for you. Diet sounds good already. I'll put good diet food, you know, the best food that you want, chef made to order, and, you know, beautiful accommodations. Rest, enjoy the day. You get 16 hours to yourself. Just give me a solid 8 hours of work. Well, the first day everybody's working, as you can imagine. Nobody's supervising them. There are no supervisors. And by the second day, one came in 15 minutes late, this and that. They stayed a little bit longer on the tennis court, and they ate a little bit too much, or they drank a little bit too much. Bekitzer, within a couple of weeks, it's hefker. Nobody's working symbolically. Now, there was one guy who knew that this was inherently wrong. It was one of the schleppers. And he was apprenticing to be a, you know, so he knew a little bit. And he says, he sees on the floor all sorts of gold string and all the wonderful materials are kind of dumped all over the place. They're not being cared for. He gathers them together. He goes into a side room. He says, you know, someday the king is going to show up and we're all going to be in trouble. And he starts fashioning a crown. And Baruch Hashem, he puts together a beautiful crown. Now comes the day of reckoning. The king comes to check out, how's my crown coming along? But he doesn't come by himself. He comes with all his ministers, and, you know, because this is like a big thing, and he shows up with his big entourage, knocks on the door. What does he see? This guy's sleeping over there. These guys are playing tennis. A couple guys are taking a sunbath, right? Everybody's having a great time. There's no work. He looks around the workroom. Nothing's happening. It's a big mess. And the king says, okay, off with your heads. That's it. And then this little guy comes, this little attendant comes and says, wait. You should know, we do have something to present to you. And he goes to the room, takes out the crown. Wow, what a crown. This guy gave it all he had. He gave it. He had siyata d'shmaya. And he put together a gorgeous, unique, creative crown. Hands it to the king, and the king says to him, you know, you just saved everybody's life over here, right? And not only that, but I'm going to give you a major promotion. You'll come with me. You become one of my top aides. And what's the pshat? He says, that's Klal Yisrael. The world is a world that has given everything. And the question is, are you the melech? It's for you, or is it for the king? And the guy that knows that it's for the king can accomplish great things. And not only that, he'll be greatly rewarded. That's the goal of Rosh Hashanah. Period. End of story. Don't daven for that. So that's what we were told. Now, let me go back and explain some of what the Seder Avodah and things in that context. So therefore, there's this double choice. You're either the Seh LaAzazel or you're Seher LaShem. Equal life, equal resources, identical. You have to make one binary choice. Are you LaShem or are you LaAzazel? Now, why is Azazel the symbol of self-promotion, self-kingship? So what do we know about a Seir Izim? Who represents Seir and Izim? Esav. Esav. What does Esav really mean? You know Esav? Why do they call him Esav? Because he was hairy. Okay? Hair conceals. Right? Good thing it does. But the hair conceals. Right? The opposite of